Development Studies at St. Augustine UWI is engaging in an annual outreach initiative called Break the Silence Youth Poster Contest, raising awareness about gender, child sexual abuse, and implications for HIV in Trinidad and Tobago. The initiative is a collaboration of IGDF and the U.S. Embassy in Port of Spain. Joining me for the conversation are the Outreach and Research Officer at IGDF, Deborah McFee, and Dr. SueAnn Barrett, who's a member of the faculty at the Institute. Why are initiatives such as the Break the Silence poster competition so important? Why do we need to talk to people about gender violence in Trinidad and Tobago?
Well, for all of us at IGDS, we feel it very necessary to bring the issues to people. We want to bring it in an accessible way. We want to bring it in a way that people can understand and connect and see the truth and the relevance of the issues. So we have these programs, these messages, these fora, etc., so that people can engage, because it's all part of raising consciousness and hopefully geared towards changing attitudes, because we can lobby for legislative change, we can lobby for cultural change and policy change, which Deborah could definitely tell you about, and some of the policy requests or mandates where we will encourage, but we need to get into the psyche of our population.
Yeah.
This is why it is so important.
So she mentioned policy. What kind of policy things do you think that we need to be doing? What have we done and what we need to do more of?
I like that question. What have we done? Because I really think, and listening to Dr. Sue and building on that, I really think we need to be very clear in terms of the fact that this activism like the Break the Silence Project and activism around domestic violence, it comes from a long history of activism. The fact that we're having this conversation in 2016, we need to be clear that in 1979, we could not be having this conversation.
Right.
So we are really part of a larger, a longer process.
And you're also kind of implying that we've improved, that things have improved. Because if we couldn't have this conversation in 79, mm-hmm. it means that, you know, we weren't at a place to even entertain mm-hmm. the conversation. Mm-hmm. At least now we could entertain the conversation.
Mm-hmm. Small changes.
Well, you know, I don't like to think of it in terms of improving.
Why?
I like to think of it in terms of the process of building mm-hmm. that awareness. Because mm-hmm. if I say improving, I stuck between this binary of good and bad, no.
Right.
I think the conversation we need to be really having is that, okay, in 79, I could not talk about, and we need to recognize that IGDS and our mm-hmm. our leaders yes. in the process,
our mothers,
Professor Rado, Professor Mohammed, these women, Professor Barito, even the women before them, Peggy Antrobus, those women, those regional fighters, they have all been part of a very long trajectory of work. The question really is for us where that work is at. And how do we build on that work? And
yeah.
I think when we get into it is improving, stop, it is bad, stop, mm-hmm. we're really doing us a disservice.
So while we have child agencies or agencies to address domestic violence and sexual violence and child challenges with children and violence and so forth, while we may have court processes and procedures,
yeah.
While there may be some legislative changes, all of which I can't outline for you
yeah.
now, what happens is that there are other cultural, structural, and historical factors that emerge that mediate how these processes can work. So essentially, while we may be able to engage in discourse, we always have to be aware that it's not always so clearly simple, because as much you have a protection order, mm-hmm. but somebody could still fine you and threaten you because
yeah.
they feel entitled,
yeah.
you know, something like that. So yes, we do have policy, we do want policy, but as we say, we want a public agenda that treats with violence against women, because of the focus of 16 days of activism, but gender-based violence as a pressing concern.
Yeah. Why do we call it gender-based violence? Because, I mean, men are violent to each other. So
yes.
You know, clarify that for me, if you can.
Yes, all right. That's a really simple explanation.
Yeah.
Now, gender-based violence is meant to be an inclusive reference mm-hmm. to account for violence experienced and perpetrated by all peoples, whether they fit within the gender binary, male, female, or they are gender nonconforming, because we don't want to exclude anyone's experience of violence. There's a tendency in our society now to do this sort of measure the victim.
Yeah.
Who is the greatest victim?
I heard it called oppression Olympics.
Yes, women experience that, but men experience it too.
Yes.
It benefits no one. When we look at gender-based, when we use that term as opposed to violence against women only, or violence against men, or violence against children, we account for the fact that violence is perpetrated because of gender and gender-related issues,
right,
including all those who are gendered. Now, when we deal with 16 days of activism to end violence against women, mm-hmm. we account for the unique positioning that women occupy.
Yeah.
And the statistical evidence, the cultural evidence, and the anecdotal narratives that say, hey, women have an experience because they are women. Deb could share her take on it.
Yeah. Well, in essence, when I think about the 16 years of activism, when I think about the whole idea of gender-based violence, I'm looking at those power relations of gender.
Mm-hmm.
And the power relations of gender speaks not only between men and women, but between and among different groups of men and different groups of women. And that power relations of gender manifests itself in very complex ways. So when I think about what are the challenges in the 16 years of activism, which mm-hmm. is marked by November 25th, which is the day to eliminate all forms of violence
yes.
against women. December 10th is Human Rights Day.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the beginning and the end.
Right.
But in between we have World AIDS Day, which we celebrated yesterday,
mm-hmm.
right? And we always need to be aware of these issues are very gendered.
Mm-hmm.
Who has access? Because mm-hmm. gender determines who has access to treatment.
Mm-hmm.
Yes? Who has access to the protection from our services, our police, our mm-hmm. our services? Let me leave it there.
Yes.
Yes, mm-hmm. let me leave it there. But what I am, the thing about gender-based violence is that language of power. Yes? How do you negotiate the power? Child sexual abuse, the manipulation of power, is completely different to that around domestic violence and intimate partner violence.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it is a
spectrum.
Quite a spectrum.
And our gender bias actually prevents us from understanding victimhood or even understanding the realities of the situation. Is that possible? Because I know in the Caribbean we say, you know, these are men behaviors, these are male behaviors, mm-hmm. these are male roles.
Mm-hmm.
So people talk about how you could leave that child alone with a man,
mm-hmm.
because men clearly are predators and can't help themselves at any opportunity.
Stereotypes.
But women do sexually abuse and physically abuse children, you know?
Yes, indeed. Gender stereotypes, gender mm-hmm. expectations, ideologies
yeah.
influence how we interpret it. Credible or legitimate victims and perpetrators.
Right.
And so we place people in roles.
Yes.
Because we have expectations either based on our personal experience, which we generalize to everyone,
mm-hmm.
or based on long-held beliefs about who, what is masculine, what is feminine marked.
Mm-hmm.
The truth is that that is one of the greatest and remains the greatest challenge today. The United Nations has recognized violence against women, especially as a human rights issue. But you have a set of ideas that I expressed that says, well, in some cases, it might be okay.
Yeah.
When it comes to men, well, in some cases, this is not relevant. So in fact, sometimes you feel like you're hitting your head against a brick wall because you have these attitudes and values and beliefs which are steeped in our cultural institutions like church and school and family and so forth. But we continue to, this is why we have processes to get people in that conversation so they will have an aha moment.
How mm-hmm. receptive are you all finding people to the conversation? People who not go into gender,
mm-hmm.
you know, IGDS, people who are not enrolled, because obviously if you're enrolled in gender, you're kind of predisposed or you're,
mm-hmm.
well, mm-hmm. we'd like to believe you're
yes.
predisposed.
Yes.
But when you have just general conversations, how are you finding people?
You know, I find the thing about gender and it's interesting, the elasticity
yes.
of gender. There's
yes.
a paper Professor Mohammed has on that. And what I find about gender, particularly talking about gender-based violence, is the people identify with certain aspects of it. So whether or not someone, there's a way in which you want to see a radical change in behavior, but I think we need to be aware that behavior change is a product of a longer, more invested process. And I guess that is why we work in this area, because you're saying sometimes someone may not respond positively, but sometimes what you really want to do is sow a seed and begin to have a conversation around what are your personal gender ideologies. And not only your personal, what we were talking about that earlier, what I find we neglect when we begin to have this conversation about my person and your person is that the community holds a particular set of gender ideals. And a lot of times we do not hold our communities, and when I say our communities, I'm talking about, we like to call them institutions, but I like to think about them as communities, our churches, our mosques, our office places, because sometimes we are living with gender-based violence next to us. But for us to get through this day, we may have to revisit that. Yeah. So I'm also very concerned about the conversation, the individual nature of the conversation that we're having, because collectively we're not really building that communal responsibility. And I think the idea of the child sexual abuse, the poster campaign, you really want to our communities to revisit that type of responsibility that we do share around gender.
Yeah.
And I want to add to that and say that you asked about people's responses.
Mm-hmm.
People respond from a personal place, a psychological response, and that community response. And usually when there are such troubling issues like gender-based violence, sexual abuse on children and innocent violence against women, people tend to apply this just world belief as an ethical principle, in the sense that good things happen to good people and bad things happen to bad people.
Right.
So you have things like victim blaming, you have shaming, you have us and them, separating self.
Yeah.
You even have, I have observed people doing a kind of hierarchy of negative behavior. So I do this, but I'm not as bad as those people who do this.
Yes, yes.
So they respond very, very in a limited way because they're saying, well, I'm not here on the spectrum of badness. And I feel then that this doesn't really apply to me, so I don't need to do anything. Leave it for those creeps or those people who are bad or those people who do the extreme. And that undermines because essentially it means that you're not willing to confront. And I think the hardest thing for all of us, even if we feel that we're enlightened, even my students, is to confront certain things that we take for granted, deal with the discomfort and the cognitive dissonance, deal with the unhappiness, deal with the, oh my God, really?
Mm-hmm.
And then move beyond it. And as Deborah says, it's really a gradual process that starts with individuals, but will persist and continue with community involvement. But it'll take time.
So since we're talking about community involvement, some of our community members in Barbados started a hashtag, Life in Leggings.
Yes.
And it started over the weekend, I think, last week.
Last week, about Thursday, I think.
Yeah. And then when I think it's going to die down, something happens. Like someone discovers it and is just absolutely shocked and appalled by what they've seen. And we were talking off camera earlier, and I'm like, yeah, people have been saying I'm going to have to start blocking and unfriending and deleting some people on my profile for their horrendous views.
Yes.
What are you thinking? What are your thoughts when you see the responses?
You know, I'll tell you that my engagement with Life in Leggings, I teach a course this semester. We introduce social media as the way forward now, especially to our young people.
Mm-hmm.
And I have my students looking for issues out there and sharing it on a private Facebook page, as Facebook being the most popular. And one of my students drew it to the class's attention, and I said, very interesting. And I started to look at it further and look at the stories, share the stories on my own timeline. And of course, you know, it mushroomed. It's a movement, and it's moving.
Mm-hmm.
The function of social media, the feature of social media, allows it to move very quickly. Last Thursday to now, when you're offline, it would have never really gone that way unless we picked up mainstream media attention. But what is interesting is that this is showing us how community gets involved. But this community is very specific. a community of women and allied men who are saying, we are challenging the silence. We are typing the silence into being, which is something that you can't do outside of social media. But as much as you speak this silenced, you know, you get, as I said, that set of responses when people are confronted. The sheer number of women in Barbados, Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago, Dominica, across the Caribbean. Right now, we have solidarity from Hollaback in the United States. There's also the newest development is to map over the weekend street harassment across the world through the BBC, which is good because it's getting traction. And everybody's wondering, well, what's the point? Mm-hmm. I'm tired of this hashtag.
Yeah.
The point is to send a message, to say to women, you see all of these stories that you've been holding in your heart and your mind for all of these years, share it with each other so you don't.
Yeah.
Feel that you're the only person to have experienced
and you're not holding this burden by yourself.
Exactly, and that you wouldn't believe that the lady next to you actually experienced something so simple. Yeah. That's the main thrust. And the organizer put up a video where she was crying and she said, "I just wanted people to know that I'm not the only crazy bee." This is TV out there.
Yes,
and the unfortunate and troubling and sad part is that the backlash is horrendous.
Yeah.
People are like, women are making up stories. Women should just be violated again. These are wasting time. There are other criminal issues, which means that they don't understand
better. The most troubling. The most troubling response is the not all men. Because I don't understand how you see the hashtag and people are talking about their personal experiences. And automatically your response is, why are you bashing all men? And I'm like, but they're not bashing all men. They're speaking about their experience.
I want to make
And if you're noticing a pattern that makes you uncomfortable.
Thank you. Confront it.
Confront it.
Confront it.
You would.
Deborah's flummoxed.
Deborah.
I can't. I'm not going to get into the not all men.
Yes.
It is clear.
Yes.
It is clear that not all men are abusers.
But that is my issue. It was clear.
I think we need to be very conscious of those things that derail.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And we need to be very cognizant of the issue with this particular activity is the fact that years ago, and I wouldn't tell you how many years ago I started in this work, someone shared a statistic that 8 out of 10 girls in the Caribbean will be touched. And then, you know, the language is important because they would talk about touch. Mm-hmm. It's sexual abuse.
Yeah. Yes.
But
we couldn't say it. We were reluctant to say sexual abuse at one point
in time. Exactly. And this is also a product of the consciousness that we can sit here and talk. It is not touched or interfered with.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so what all that to say, the fact is, we have an issue, and this is why this is the oldest policy issue around gender-based violence. Mm-hmm. Violence against women is our oldest policy issue. Mm-hmm. And what my thinking is, once public policy has become invested in a process, you are now saying this is no longer about the personal.
This is
very, very, very political, and there's a need for our institutions to pay attention to this. But what I find with this particular piece of work, and I love the fact that this is a forum that women are taking charge, and they say this happened. What I find with this whole process is that it is also interrogating how effective public policy has dealt with this.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it is saying to us, the fact remains that we need to push. We need to push the public policy discourse, because a lot of women are then saying, this happened to me and I could not.
Mm-hmm.
I could not. The school, the security services, my mom, my dad, we need to be clear. And it's not only public policy around gender-based violence. Yeah, we need to really have this conversation. What hinders, why our girls have to become women before they're able to say, this happened?
Yes.
And how do we then say, listen,
how do we make space for girls to be able to say, this happened, I don't want it to happen again.
I just wanted to make four things clear, because life in leggings is hot.
Mm-hmm.
It's sexy right now.
Yeah.
And it's very, very profound,
mm-hmm.
because women are speaking things that they weren't allowed to
and
speak.
And it's Caribbean women, which is what Caribbean I really like about it.
Right?
It's a very Caribbean-centered piece of action. So it's like our realities are coming to the forefront.
Yes. The 8 out of 10 of us.
Yes. That's
that number is staggering.
But right now, the statistics in terms of rape and sexual violence, the Caribbean leads in the world. We have well, of course, statistics per capita, so mm-hmm. however they work it out, Bahamas is at the top in the world.
Wow.
Jamaica and St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Other countries in the Caribbean, the rate of sexual violence.
But you said you had some points you wanted
to... Yes, sorry, let me focus on this. Let me not
because we don't have too much time.
Yes,
we,
let
we
me just make some points.
Time.
First thing I wanted to say,
mm-hmm.
this is not about man bashing.
Yeah.
It's not about men, for once.
Let's say that again.
It
this
is not
about
men
bashing.
No.
Yes.
This is about... talking to each other and saying, it's okay to talk about that thing that you didn't think you would have been believed, that you didn't think you would have gotten help. A woman put up a story about actually reporting it to the police,
mm-hmm.
and the police in her country telling her, tell me the truth. You really was involved with this person. You know?
Mm-hmm.
This is about talking about the attitudes that women experience, that women live because they're women, one. And communicating to our men, both the good ones and the not so good ones, that you need to attend to this real and revisit your behavior. Number two, this is not, women in the Caribbean are embroiled in a set of belief systems, respectability and responsibility.
Yeah.
Women in the Caribbean feel shame about things that they don't need to feel shame about. So we need to understand why is it like if we're purging? Because we're purging a set of issues that are very, very, very difficult to express.
Mm-hmm.
Women are editing, women are asking other women to speak for them, women are speaking anonymously, and they are trying, and they are still engaged in a process of self-censorship to protect men who they care about.
Yeah.
So this reinforces the idea that it's not man bashing. And number three, it is because we live in the age of social media,
mm-hmm.
which enhances our ability to communicate, that we can finally have a push to the policymakers. Hey, hear our voice. And the other thing is, backlash will always exist.
Yeah, always.
So we don't want. So I try my best not to be too preoccupied with the backlash, because people find great difficulty confronting the uncomfortable.
And it's a very uncomfortable. It's
very uncomfortable.
Deborah, really, really quickly, what sort of policy things do you think that we need to start looking at really quickly?
Really quickly?
Yeah.
So we're outed our Jamaican and Bahamian friends, but we in Trinidad dealing with the whole issue of child marriage.
Yes.
We need to bring that piece of legislation before our parliament that will end child marriage. There's a national strategic plan on gender-based violence and sexual violence. We need to dig it up. We have to dig it up and bring it before wherever it has to go. The cabinet, you please approve it, move on it, right? And we need to look specifically for me, we need to look at the data collection silos that we have created around gender-based violence. Someone sent an email wanting, you want data on gender-based violence. We need to really work out. We need to bring the person into the data forms that we currently have, and we need to look at the whole harmonization process. But we've had that conversation nationally before.
But I guess we need to bring it back up again.
Definitely.
Yes.
Right? Ladies, it's always too short when we have conversations like these, but I guess we're going to have to do it again. Thank you so much, Dr. SueAnn Barrett, for joining me. Thank you so much, soon-to-be Dr. Deborah McFee, for joining me for this very special edition of Conversations with CNews. I'm Sweeney Gray. We'll see you next time.